People and the oceans are inextricably linked. And sometimes it can be easy to forget that, but you can't really forget that when you're here. Not when you're surrounded by it, you see it all the time around you every day.
We were one of the first American universities to establish a marine field station. The seeds of who we are were planted back then by Dr. Pearse in the 30s. We teach still to small classes, which we cherish. Still a very different experience than you get on main campus, which we also cherish. So getting out, getting wet, salty, muddy, that's what we like.
And in a fantastic location to do both coastal and offshore research, and even the amount of research done right off these docks.
Welcome, everybody. My name is Andy Reid, one of the faculty members here, and I'm also the director of the Marine Lab. I know a lot of you have been by here on boats and wonder what the heck it is we do here. I hope we're able to answer a bunch of those questions.
There's no place in the world better than Duke for that kind of interdisciplinary approach. You put people from different fields together and the magic happens.
The magic of the Duke Marine Lab began shortly after the formation of Duke University. In the 1930s, Arthur Pearse sought an active research site for his students.
Dr. Pearse, who was a member of the zoology department, had come to the coast to collect animals for his students to study. And he thought it would be a good idea for Duke to invest in some land here so there could be a field station. Dr. Pearse had looked all over the coast of North Carolina for a suitable place, from as far south as Charlotte up to the Outer Banks, and settled on this place, I think, for a couple of reasons. First, because it was relatively close to Durham. Second of all, because it was adjacent to what was then the Bureau of Commercial Fisheries Lab, what is now the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's lab. And the first buildings were completed in 1938. The boathouse, one research laboratory, and three dormitories. And that was the beginning of the story that we're still telling today.
The story of the Marine Lab continued with one of its most important figures, Dr. C.G. Bookhout.
Bookie, as he was known to everyone, got his PhD in zoology in the 30s, came down here with Dr. Pearse. Dr. Bookhout was director for 18 years.
When he was director, he was responsible for much of what we now know as the Marine Lab.
Bookie was loved by everybody. Our primary research building is named after him now.
He was one of the pilings on which the Marine Lab was built. He had the vision.
That vision included promoting the Marine Lab to help it grow into something bigger, which Dr. Bookhout did with a promotional video in 1951.
The University Marine Laboratory is located at Beaufort, North Carolina. The Beaufort area is strategically located from a biologist's point of view. It is within the southern range of a great many northern marine plants and animals, and within the northern range of a host of southern species.
Dr. Bookhout also took scientific learning to a new level during his time as director of the Marine Lab.
So one of the things that Dr. Bookhout did was to establish the research vessel Eastward, which was one of the first research vessels of its kind anywhere in the country. The Eastward was an iconic ship, and the idea that academic institutions could support oceanographic research by hosting research vessels was something that Bookhout developed. That idea was his.
That idea helped lead to a moment that significantly boosted the Marine Lab's profile.
So my dad, John Newton, was a marine geologist, and he realized that the same tools, the geophysics tools, the side scan sonar, the magnetometer, could be used to find the most famous missing ship in America, and that was the USS Monitor.
In 1973, Cathryn joined her father on an expedition of interdisciplinary scientists to find the USS Monitor, a Union Civil War ship that had sunk off the coast of North Carolina over 100 years ago.
Doc Edgerton had developed what was known as side scan sonar. And so John Newton and Doc Edgerton got together and put it on the Eastward and looked for the Monitor and in fact found it. And it raised the profile of the Marine Lab internationally.
It ran above the fold in the New York Times. It was a story on the CBS Nightly News with Walter Cronkite. It was just all over the world. What a high moment for the Duke Marine Lab and for Duke University.
The Eastward was the first ship in a tradition of research vessels at the Duke Marine Lab.
There's no question that research vessels are important for training and research, for experiential learning.
And we think a lot about that tradition, the tradition of conducting research from academic institutions, sometimes in coastal waters, sometimes way out in the middle of the ocean. And today, we continue that tradition with the RV Shearwater, our beautiful new research vessel. So we just took students off to sea. For most of them, it was the first time they'd ever been at sea overnight, first time they'd ever been in a place where they couldn't see land. And those experiences are just really formative, in addition to learning how to do science on a boat, which is tricky. And I think that's another example of the type of immersive field experience that we can offer here that's really unusual.
As the Marine Lab continued to grow, it became evident that a more unified structure would be beneficial.
The Marine Lab was sort of a satellite of Duke, and it was a full-service campus. I mean, it had resident faculty, but it didn't have an intellectual context. Why was it there? Who was it going to serve? And then all of that changed. We started working towards a new unit in the university called the School of the Environment. And then it got funded by Pete Nicholas. And it was wonderful for the Marine Lab. As I say, it put it in an intellectual construct that it didn't have before. And it has prospered in that construct.
One of the ways it prospered was through the innovative introduction of social scientists to the faculty.
You know, Marine Labs don't traditionally have social scientists.
So these are people who study human communities all over the world, decision-making, how policy is formulated. They don't study natural ecosystems and animals, but they study the human communities that depend on those systems. And you can't talk about conserving and restoring those systems without fully embracing the fact that humans are part of that solution.
The work that the faculty did to make this a place that someone like me would want to come, I think it's a huge part of the history of the lab.
Also part of the Marine Lab's history and its future is Duke's climate commitment.
I want my research to have an impact, not just within my specific field, but research that can be applied in a way to directly address the climate crisis.
You can't think about addressing climate without thinking about oceans. Where a lot of our oxygen comes from, it's where a lot of our carbon dioxide goes to, what regulates our atmosphere and our weather. But if you're not thinking about oceans, then you're not really thinking seriously about climate. But we can also be a demonstration project for Duke to show the broader society how we can still maintain coastal communities in places like this that are so vulnerable. I think that's our big challenge, and I think we're up for it, and I know we have the support of the university. We remind ourselves to spend only 20% of the time talking about the problems and spending most of the time, 80% of our time, talking about solutions.
One of those solutions took shape in the form of the drone lab that was added in 2015, taking the Marine Lab's research to new heights.
We're at the forefront of the science associated with climate change. With the technologies that we have, we're better able to quantify what's happening.
And both for traffic, Pivers Island, we have drone activity on the south end of Pivers Island below 300 feet.
With my research hat, I'm able to go out and measure some of the toxins going into our waterways. And when I became mayor, being able to fix infrastructure that had been neglected for decades. I'm very proud of the progress that we made in the Marine Lab and in the community as well.
Being community and solution focused is something that sets the Duke Marine Lab apart from other institutions.
The Marine Lab is part of the fabric of the community. We have capacity here like few places in the universe.
It's been an institutional investment by our directors.
Since its early days, each director of the Marine Lab has had a strong connection with the community in the campus's hometown, Beaufort. Notably, Dr. John Coslow served as the mayor of Beaufort, guiding the town through desegregation in the 1960s, and later established the Beaufort Boardwalk. Cindy Vandover became the Marine Lab's first female director in 2006. She saw the importance of connecting with the community by hosting an open house on the Marine Lab's campus, a tradition that's still carried on today.
Just having a vision that opening the doors would be a huge part of the story of our relationship with the community. And so that was really powerful.
We are so happy to see so many people on island today, so many folks in our community.
Oh,
hey! Yeah, yes, hey there. Look at the hat, man.
Yeah.
Hi. Oh, you are! Hey.
I finally got to see the boat.
You know, our kids are in the communities and we're in the communities through our kids often. And it's one of the things that being a little bit smaller has made a little bit easier.
In Raleigh, in Durham, in Washington, D.C., you may talk about climate change. Here in Beaufort, it's personal. We have seen the increase in frequency and ferocity of the storms. After Hurricane Florence, it was Duke students, staff, faculty that went out to underserved, overlooked communities, knocked on doors, and said, what do you need? The power of the Marine Lab just can't be overstated. I'm just so proud of the colleagues that we have here at the Marine Lab.
This care for the surrounding community starts with the tight-knit camaraderie of the students and faculty at the Marine Lab.
One thing that happens to me pretty often here is I will get asked at a moment's notice to hop on the boat and go help someone with their project. And I know that other people in the community would do that for me too, and it's really great.
I feel like I know everyone here. I know what they do. I know what they care about. And the fact that everybody is passionate about the environment makes it easy to get along with everybody.
The family-like nature of the Duke Marine Lab has been present through its entire history and has been a major part of its ability to grow.
Those greats from the lab that were here 60 years ago, wouldn't they be surpassingly proud? This would be exactly in the spirit of what the Marine Lab has been and needs to continue to be.
It has evolved into a first-rate marine institute. It is one of the darlings of the Marine Labs of the United States. I'm proud to be part of its heritage, very proud.
The network of people who know about the Marine Lab, what it is we do here, the kind of experiences that people have when they're here is just gonna continue to grow on. And that's something I wanna be part of, is really putting that Duke Marine Lab name out there.